Spot on.
Mackay from the wing position on the member stand side. Oh, Jasalenko, you beauty!
Second half, I just had this three. Strong feeling, a hunch, it's they're called hunches. But no, Ted's got to go on now.
There is a pig at full forward. Mike has never forgiven me.
16 years ago, how long do you want, how long do I have to pay for it?
A lot of people say, I'm so Dipper, no media. But hang on, I'm not media, I'm Dipper,
It wasn't a good thing that he did, but that was a poor choice of words by me.
I can't wait for Andrew and Sally. It's going to be a big night. Dermot and Dipper join us right after this, the opening round.
Think about it, footy is a strange game. Strange, I mean, to people who don't follow it. Have you ever tried to explain our rules and tactics to someone from overseas? They look at you like you're one of Sheedy's Martians, or you're a few kangaroos short in Pagan's paddock.
He is a champion!
If you've ever seen foreigners watching our footy on the box, they go crackers over the silliest things.
Look at him saying, Scotty, I'll give him one for you.
They're crazy about the goal umpies, and Lloydie chucking grass in the air just because there's a roof. And they can't work out what the boundary riders are about.
Yeah, just a gain yardage.
Imagine all those poor buggers on the other side of the world trying to fathom what Dipper's saying.
Yeah, good on you, Bruce. I've got to tell you, the Bombers are certainly pumped up. Fletcher back in the side. He's going to be the designated kicker. He'll be going for the go-to man, and that's Hurdy, of course. This is going to be a big one, Bruce.
Got it, Dip. Funny thing is, we can follow what's going on. We've grown up with it, changed with it, lived for the big ones. And over 45 years on Seven, we've seen lots of great games. Shiploads of them. And loved every minute.
McLeod might get involved here. He does. Perry uses him. He bursts McLeod. He'll try and draw someone to him. He's bursting. He's inside 50. Sure. Keeps it low. It's straight. Oh. He is a genius. He's just about the best. I haven't been turned on like this in a long, long while, I can tell you.
Those games, those teams, those characters have become part of our lives. A big part. My first memories are of barracking for the Doggies. That's me old man playing at Braybrook. And just along from him, that's a bloke called Teddy Whitten. I can't remember anything I learned about history or geography, but ask me which side of the ground the Doug Hawkins wing is.
Hit the boundary line!
Or who yelled hit the boundary in St Kilda's Premiership, or who Helen D'Amico is, and mate, I'm a Rhodes Scholar. Truth is, there are millions like me, fans who've lived through and loved the footy on Seven. Of course, we supporters have always worn our hearts on our sleeves. Recognise this lunatic? Yeah, he wore a silly hat back then too. Molly had just been telling his Saints to get a wriggle on. But compared to most followers of the game, Molly's almost normal. Almost. Yeah, we've all been caught up in the madness of footy.
Bond comes in, does it magnificently. Elliott couldn't control it. Dundas's little give to Bond. Here's a go. Bond to Maxfield. Go and kick the goal, Stewie. Straighten it up. Bang it home. It's a beauty. They're in front of the Tigers. Won't that lift it off the ground?
The pocket over the head of Thompson and goes. Dacos. This is where he's at his best. The Mustard.
He's run 100 metres in 9.78. He's running faster than the footy. Could this be an unbelievable goal? Lines them up. What a goal! It's one of the greats of all time.
We're going to clever tap.
Yeah, there've been countless moments that have been special.
When you're hot, you're hot.
Can I officially say that was very, very special?
Well, I'm probably known for a couple of things, but the one that always stick with me is special, isn't it? So many people come up to me at airports and in shopping centres and say, can you just say it, Bruce? Just once.
McLeod with some space. Great left foot goal. Is that special or what?
Sirikovsky, number 13, right in the back from Gavilich. Jack Hill, the blind miner, could have seen that one.
Jack Hill, the blind miner, he'd make the Ming the Merciless look like a philanthropist. And yeah, just things that came off your tongue at the time. And so that was part of it. And we when we started, you know, as the pioneers, we didn't have any guidelines.
Oh, Michael, you might be right. This could be a draw.
I tip this.
The atmosphere here is electric. We say this every year, but it seems to get bigger and bigger every year.
Lou Richards certainly enriched the atmosphere for Mike Williamson and for Peter Landy, with whom he called 9 grand finals from 76 till 86.
Good afternoon, Peter.
And good afternoon to Bob Scott.
Good afternoon, Pete.
As soon as I'd start calling, he'd light up. And it was really, you know, bloody annoying when you're a non-smoker. And Bob never used to like it either. And as soon as I'd tap Lou on the shoulder, the cigarette would go down, the binoculars would go up, and he'd start. And I'd be putting my foot on the damn cigarettes and the procedure would continue.
Ever wonder why the director didn't tell Louie to butt out? Well, Alf Potter's hands were full. It was, as Louie used to say, on for young and old in the commentary box and on the boundary.
Before we get mobbed by North Melbourne supporters, I think we'll take you up to Bob and Lou upstairs.
Because we've known him so well, often as well as our own families, we fans have always delighted in bagging the TV blokes.
Stars of the past competition. Better than that, I hope.
Sometimes made a meal of them. Love them one week, want to punt them the next. And as soon as they're gone, we get all teary.
Dick Reynolds, it's lovely to have you here. And as I said before, I'm very sincere when I say one of the greatest footballers that I've ever seen.
Anyway, thank you, Jack. You've been great. And I do appreciate all the years, the fun and the... Well, we used to hate one another. Now,
yeah,
we
don't. But you told me if I gave you a push-up, you'd push me up. That's right.
Jack Dyer was Dad's favourite. Mum couldn't stand Louie. Always had a soft spot for Timmy, though, even when Timmy had the wind up him.
There's a blustery wind. I think it's favouring the left of screen, although I went out onto the ground at the end of the reserves game and it was blowing both ways.
Can he take it away?
Well, he'll never make a weatherman. And if Timmy's first game was a culture shock, being a 15-year-old from Dimboola, imagine the next up, when he fronted for World of Sport.
And they opened the door into the actual studio where the show was being recorded live, and it was just like entering a party, a private party. You know, and the noise, obviously, you know, they're off camera at the time and they'd gone to an ad or whatever, and the noise, and there was, you know, like there's a haze of smoke just hanging over the top of everybody.
Yep, Louie was there. World of Sport was such a fixture in our lives, churches actually scheduled their services earlier so the faithful could get home in time for the opening hymn.
A big welcome to World of Sport. Football presents the House of Stuff. Geelong and Hawthorn yesterday, a few of the boys must have carried a grouch. Fisticuffs elsewhere.
Case, the chimp, Louis the Lip, Captain Blood, Bobby Davis, all legends in our lounge rooms. The handball, champion kick,
Rod Olsen at the Kenny.
Touch footy, who thought of that?
Gets the ball back here to Cummings.
Here's yet another beauty from...
And that lunatic Uncle Doug.
Nut and fruit selections. Fruit and nuts.
If Unc wasn't flogging chocolates, he was throttling Louie. And Mum was yelling for Unc to go harder.
Fair enough, I'll take your advice and get a Repco Girl Star engine fitted straight away.
Feel like you're reliving your childhood? Well, we've only just started. What do you reckon, Unc?
Oh, how about it so far? Is your appetite wet? Well, like Jack Hill the Blind Miner, you ain't seen nothing yet. 45 years of footy, and each one a winner. 7's plonked on your plate, a gourmet TV dinner. So don't touch that dial, I implore you. Please, stay. We'll be back in a flash from the break with DJ. Ha ha, 7, you're looking great. Woof.
Well, Ted, how does it feel to be walking down this lane, approaching the ground for your last game?
It feels bloody awful, David.
Does it?
I don't feel very happy about it at all.
Yeah.
It has to come, and this is it. The skies haven't been too good to us either, really.
That afternoon, when Teddy played his last game, I saw old ladies cry and strong men turn away. To us in the Golden West, E.J. Witten was like a Greek god. Just lather the oil into that big hairy chest, and the boy from Braybrook could leap tall buildings and be more powerful than a locomotive. Working class people had a larrikin hero, our own Mr. Football.
Mr. Whitten.
Mr. Football, if you like.
Did you ever give some back chat to the little man in white?
Never talked an umpire in my life, except to say g'day.
Tell me, Teddy Whitten.
Mr. Football, if you like.
Did you ever whack the enemy when the ball was out of sight?
Hey, you've got the wrong bloke. I only whacked them when the ball was in sight.
Teddy, EJ, it all sounds like football to me, to me. Teddy, EJ, it all sounds like football to me.
I said to you at half time that providing we control the rucks in the air like we were doing, we've got a real chance. In that quarter, yeah, you let their rucks get on top of us a little bit, particularly from the centre bounce and around the ground, which we can't afford to do. You had them in your hand and you've let them out. Now we've got to get them back in there and close it up. They played attacking football. We went negative in that quarter. And you can't afford to. They want attacking purposeful football all the time. And providing you had it kept up in that quarter, we had a real chance of winning it in that quarter. Now we've got our backs against the wall and we've got to fight, and we're going to fight hard. It's going to be a do-or-die effort. It's going to be a determined bit. You've got to show me all the guts and all the determination you've got in your body. You've got to inspire me with this last quarter bid. You've been in front all day, you've got to stay there. Are you going to sit there?
Get on there.
I've got a big effort there. Come on, son.
That afternoon, we all got soaked. But geez, it was worth it.
To any of the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of telegrams, cards, telephone calls and good wishes that have been bestowed upon me in this last week. But collectively, I'd like to say to each and every one of you, and you are the people that know who sent them, a magnificent thank you. I love you all. I hope you stick with it.
Teddy kept talking and talking, and we didn't want him to stop, because we knew that when he did, a chapter of our lives would be over.
And in closing, I'd like to say to you all, again, tremendously, from the bottom of my heart, a big thank you. I'm starting to feel a bit sad and sorry about it.
That's the bloody last time I've been taking them off.
Hanging up the boots has never been easy, for the heroes or for the fans.
Has ever simply ceased to exist overnight. But if Fitzroy doesn't raise $800,000 by June the 30th...
The heart of footy missed exactly a beat the day Fitzroy died.
107 years, 8 Brownlows, 8 Premierships will all be buried forever.
Yeah, so long, Fitzroy. Thanks for the memories. And I guess that's all...
And I reckon a few TV sets got turned off that afternoon.
And it's taken 100 years for them to finally succumb to the pressures, I suppose, of the modern football as we know it.
They aren't the Fitzroy of old, but the Brisbane Lions have become a force, a mighty force.
All class Williams has kicked a magnificent goal.
The Richmond Tigers are facing extinction. Liquidators have us in their sights. Save our skin.
For the Victorian-based clubs, it seems every year's a battle. And don't we know it. The Doggies had one almighty scrap with the league, which we won, so far.
Evans may have the last kick in this grand final. The Eagles are going to win their first leg.
But you've got to hand it to those interstaters. They know how to win. The first interstate team to win a flag was the Eagles in 1992, going one better than their grand final loss the previous year.
City became a ghost town with its
population. We saw a vision of that Channel 7 had taken of the main freeway leading into Perth with just no cars on it, at the, you know, in that 2 hours that the grand final was on, they had the time-lapse camera going and just showing that it was just a deserted town. People were indoors wherever they could be watching the football. It was that big that people were just glued to their sets and living it all through the TV.
Evans over the top. Matera somehow gets out of jail. Peter Matera, 52 metres, pulls it back. What a magnificent kick for goal. Oh, he can fire it up. Suddenly the Eagles are alive. Matera sets sail behind. And the Eagles hit the ground.
The Eagles are premiers for the second time in three seasons.
Medina in the middle. Now Michael Long. Look at this boy go. Away goes Michael Long. 50 metres out. Still going. 30 metres out. Oh, what play. It may have been touched on the line. No. Towards Jarman. Jarman. Yes. Dylan Jarman.
When the Crows won the first of their successive premierships, Seven's telecast was the most watched television event in Adelaide's history.
Jarman again, round the body, that'll do! Oh, that will do! Oh, unbelievable!
We actually had a ticker tape parade the Tuesday after the grand final, and I think there was over 100,000 people lining the streets, and we were like the Beatles. It was unbelievable. It was just, it was amazing. And we went to the showgrounds in Adelaide, and I think there was 50 or 60,000 people there, jam-packed in there, and that was just, oh, it was unbelievable, the reception we had there.
Grand finals have defined heroes, from Hooker Harrison tagging Barassi in 58, to Barry Breen with that wobbly point, to Teddy Hopkins, and who could forget Phil Manassa's run?
Demon attack goes for a run. Almost towards the half 4-9. He is now. He's got 50 metres. He takes the handball. No pain for the handball. He won't give it Manassa. He's going to shoot the goal. And he's put it through. He's put it through. By golly.
He fires for the goal. And he's put it through.
I watched two or three times Dermot Brereton get up from when Yatesy hit him and go to his position, and he was obviously very badly hurt, you know, and was vomiting and, you know, but the strength of character of the fella to keep on going and still take an important part of the game, that to me is, you know, is still one of the great ingredients that makes football the game that it is.
Playing it now, doing the ruck work against Deer. Have got over the top. Snapshot by Gary out. This is
Hawthorn's first ever back-to-back premiership team, you know. 89 grand final. Then you throw in the mix of what happened in the 89 grand final with players going down and the crowd and Abler kicking 9 goals. And it was just a great part to be of history. I mean, it's... People stop me in the streets and say, hey, listen, I don't play for Geelong nor Hawthorn, but can I just say what a great game that was? It was what football's all about. In one day, we got everything.
Gary Hamilton has won it. Oh, he was a tremendous player, Dennis. He was the man who was either going to win the game or keep Geelong in it. And with 9 goals, what a fantastic game.
And I'd just like to thank God for making it all possible. Thank you.
The first one I called was 1990, and that always held a special significance for me because my son who died barracked for Collingwood, so he got to see Collingwood, his side, win a flag, so that was a great thrill for him.
In many ways it was a very sad day because if you remember, the siren sounded. Darren Mullane, who had an injured hand, I think, or thumb,
when the siren sounded, was left holding the footy, and it was only a short time later that Darren himself was killed in a car accident.
It was an emotional display of loyalty, the hallmark of the Collingwood club, known for its fierce allegiance.
If you measure affection by the size of the congregation, we have embraced our footy heroes, forgiven their failings, glorified their greatness.
You are a Collingwood son. You belong to Collingwood. And this day, Mum and Dad, you sons, we weep with you, we bleed for you, we cry with you.
In honour of the memory of the great St Kilda footballer who passed away, Trevor Barker, on Friday morning.
Wave goodbye to Teddy Whitten for the last time. His state funeral was broadcast live on two television networks.
Mere words could never do justice to EJ the man. He was and will always be a symbol for the western suburbs.
Great sense of sadness and loss, but at the same time a tremendous sense of thanksgiving and a recognition of what a strength Ted has been to so many.
Dad, you really were my hero, and I love you, mate.
Kev, do you still believe? Now, where is Kev? Look at that. He's going to have to sprint. Are you going to sprint, Kev? You can come in between Jack and Bob. Just sit down, quietly.
Haven't got a chair to sit down.
We'll come in over here.
This ramshackle mob, barely held together by Ron Casey and later Sandy Roberts, ruled our lounge rooms for 28 years. World of Sport was a Melbourne institution.
Obviously things have happened since I've been away for a couple of weeks. However, yes it is.
Things have changed a bit, Ron.
Good on you, darling.
It was a delight to go to the World of Sport. It genuinely was. And I would get all the gossip and the stories from Louis and Jack and from Roberts and, you know, everyone.
When the stars weren't gossiping or gagging, they were tugging for dear life.
Richmond take it out and Richmond have won. Look at that Richmond team as they hit the deck, losing the snap and then fighting back all the way.
Undoubtedly, the toughest job was being a judge on champion kick. There wasn't a long queue of volunteers to judge when Big Nick was a contestant.
I never found football humorous as such. I couldn't get there like Lou and Jack Dyer and Crackers do. They get there and tell story after story after story. But to me, football was so serious.
But what the viewers loved most about World of Sport and league teams was the stuff-ups, and luckily there were plenty of them.
All right, well, let's take this message while we're getting underway, and then we'll be back with the Spalding handball semi-final. Well, we can't go because we haven't got any balls.
After that, they kept a close eye on their balls.
Casey never wanted anything that was had a double entendre or was a little bit rude or anything. He didn't like that at all, so we just behaved ourselves tremendously, except this day about the golf. And Louis there getting a lesson from Colin Long, and I walked in and said, "By golly, you're not bad, Louis, you." He said, "I'm a champion."
I said, oh, yeah, where do you play? What course do you play? And he said, I play at all the courses around Melbourne. He's back on the intercourse chairman of Melbourne. And that was it. We didn't have too good a day for the rest of the day. In fact, I think we were reprimanded fairly strongly from game.
Oh, hello. Ring back, lad. I'm doing the recipe, will you?
Turned up, Edna. He hasn't got time now.
No, it's Menzies, the chef.
We're having curried fish balls.
What?
Yeah, we need 125 grams of cold cooked fish.
How many fish would you need for 125 fish balls?
Not too many, but I'll tell you, 125 grams.
While Casey played the headmaster, the naughty boys created their own fireworks.
Uncle Doug was a bad man. I mean, he's a lovely man, but he was a terror. And he'd do one of either two things to the new boys, guys like me. And it was basically, to become a part of World of Sport, you had to pass what could be described as initiation test. So Doug would conduct the initiation test, and you would be given a 30-second script on auto-cue, and you would start to read it. But then you'd see him light the bottom of the script with his cigarette lighter. So all of a sudden, this 30-seconder became more like 17 seconds because you're quickened up trying to get it through before the flames ate up all the words.
And in fact, we still have Miss Australia with us in Leanne Cock and Leanne Dick, I should say. And Leanne, it's going to be very interesting to we come to the stage now, and that is, I guess, fashions on the field. And we're looking
well,
at some of the best.
Well, as soon as I said it, I just sensed that she turned to stone.
Sandy passed Unc's initiation.
Oh, I remember one day they set fire to when Sam Newman was doing a live commercial, and they had the idiot sheet which Sam was reading from, and they set fire to that, and as Sam was trying to do the commercial, the idiot sheet was going up in flames.
Thousands of people coming from...
Bobby Davis remembers they were getting $3 a week.
All over Australia.
I can tell you this now. Lou, Jack and I... we decided one year that we would go up and front case and see if we thought we were probably worth a bit more money. And we walked into Case's palatial office and he said, sit down, boys, or something, you know, and we're all there looking. And he said, now, what is it you want? And we're just about to, I think Louis was the spokesman, Louis probably just about to blurt out what we were going to do. He said, if it's about money, there's nothing to talk about, because that's it. If it's anything else, just sit down, we'll have a nice drink. And that was it.
The first memories of the television footy show would be Ron Barassi's footy show, or the footy show that Ron Barassi was on in the 60s, with the black boots and the white boot laces, and always watch your boots, like, you know, boot laces, boys, and if you can't be a footballer, look like a footballer.
Ron, very interesting indeed.
Thank you, Princess.
Something that I find
a lot of my opponents, I used to get jibes when I played football, that I was amounting to the fact that I was on with Princess Panda, which was not true. But, you know, it goes on a football field.
And in the shape of a mini car.
Oh, hi, kids. Welcome to Junior Supporters Club. Today is the biggest day of my life, meeting the Osmond brothers. It's fantastic. It's a thrill of my lifetime, and I'd like to join your group.
The Osmond Brothers, we're the Osmond Brothers.
Four Quarters presents the 1995 Grand Finale.
after that, what do you do for an encore?
Pull fire away, Kylie.
Wait.
Just got to pull my...
Pull the socks off.
I'll help you there. No.
Pull up, Dougie.
Okay, ready?
Fire away. Go!
Yeah, that's not a bad encore.
Get that one out of the way. Come up, come right up here.
Jason Dunstall was as cool as a cucumber up front for the Hawks, but on this night... he was shaking in his boots.
Hello and welcome everyone to the premiere of Live and Kicking. We're
incredibly down here nervous. At the Windsor Theatre. Absolutely. Probably the most nervous I've ever been. Purely and simply because it was the first time be hosting a live TV show, and we weren't quite sure what the response was going to be. There were so many people waiting to see what we served up to them, and it was a I guess it was a turbulent time. This weekend, I'll play this weekend, but then I'll be retiring from league football. So this weekend will be my last game.
Dougie and Dipper couldn't let go of their rat bag pass, those carefree clashes on the Doug Hawkins wing.
I've got you again, old fella.
There was one time,
go on,
he did this. Right?
Boys, I'm going long. Going long.
I was running this way, then I went.
Yes, Bruce. It has been special.
Join me, Lee Matthews and Mike Shen for Talking Footy, a special program.
We TV viewers can thank our lucky stars that even after 45 years, there's one sure bet about footballers. However silly one might look, there's always another prepared to go that one step further. Adam Huskers again.
Is your mind playing tricks? Is your memory rotten? Well, if you're like me, half that stuff you've forgotten. Memories and moments and giggles galore. Rat bags and rippers and jokers and more. Blast the nostalgia and keep it coming all night. And I love looking slimmer in that old black and white. Oh, yes. Seven. You've been good for football.
It all began at a quarter past four on Easter Saturday 1957. In privileged lounge rooms across Melbourne, newfangled TV sets crackled into life, showing the last quarter of a game in which Essendon beat Collingwood. Some things never change.
These days were medieval, so you used to climb up ladders to get to baskets underslung from the roofs of grandstands or... constructed canopies on the roof, and used to freeze, absolutely freeze. And if there was a wind blowing, as often there was, well, you're in threat of ending up in the crowd.
The footy was so popular on TV that the VFL reckoned it hurt their crowd numbers. So in 1961, they pulled the plug.
Is there any possibility of the final series being televised as far as the Victorian Football League is concerned?
Well, no, Ron, the league's decision's already been made.
Ron Barassi, it's unbelievable.
When footy came back in 62, Mike Williamson was on the box, in the box, and over the coach's box.
There's John Kennedy, he's more worried.
And John Kennedy, you could hear him all over Australia when he started to bellow. He's in the coach's box, and above the coach's box is our scaffolding with Butch Gale and myself. 10 minutes into the first quarter, Kennedy, John Kennedy, straight out onto the ground, looked up at us and said, Michael, for God's sake, will you bloody well shut up? I can't hear myself think.
Mike Williamson and the panel of experts in Football Inquest. Guests this Saturday are Doug Wade, Graham Moss, Royce Hart, Lynn Thompson, Adrian Gallagher, Gary Dempsey, Carl Ditterich and Alex Jezelenko.
You could go on television in those days with a head like a busted scene shoe and not be able to string words together, and they called you a star. Because it was different, they hadn't seen anything like this in their homes.
Saturday means football, but on 7, the ball bounces this Friday night. Top guests join the panel of football greats for an on-the-ball preview of the first semi in the Kevin Dennis Football Show. This Friday at 7 on 7.
If the blokes filming the footy in the 60s thought they were at the cutting edge, well, along came the sensational 70s.
second in a row for the Tigers, or North's first ever. This Saturday, the big replay brings you the big one. Richmond versus North Melbourne with no prize for second. Football Inquest and replay, Saturday on 7.
74 was the last grand final telecast in black and white.
Grand final day started for Channel 7 technicians more than 24 hours before the ball was bounced. Friday morning, and a small convoy of vehicles led by the huge outside broadcast unit set out from the Channel 7 studios for the MCG. First to be set up is the link, so-called because of its vital link between the OB van and the Channel 7 transmitter. Set high above the MCG, this microwave reflector is attached by cable to the van and then accurately aligned in a direct line of sight to a similar reflector mounted on the tower at the South Melbourne studios.
Michael Williamson, on behalf of Lou Richards, welcoming you to the 74 Grand Final.
And then it's on. And a finely tuned team of experts make it all look so easy.
Taps it down, takes it. Barm crashes his way through the pack, tries a hand pass, picked up by Bradley Smith.
Footy leapt into colour in 1975 when the Kangaroos won their first flag.
Now Blight would have to kick this. Oh, he'd have to kick it 85, 90 metres. It's not over yet. Not over yet. What drama here at Prince's Park. Malcolm Blight, it's a big kick. It's a mammoth kick.
He's off target. It's rolling towards the boundary line and Harms almost makes ground. He tips it back to Sheldon and it's a goal! Quick as the kick.
Well, the Monday morning traffic ties me up the bloody wall, and Tuesday through to Friday gets me down. But the feeling quickly passes when the weekend comes again, and I line up all my tickets at the ground.
Oh, I do love the Saturday arvo when me mates and I go up to see the game. Oh, I do.
With the rain all down my neck, ain't the kind of thing to make me jump and shout,
jump and shout.
But I'm full of consolation when a ruckman traps the ball and kicks a sausage roll from 60 metres out.
Oh, I do love a Saturday arvo when me mates and I go up to see the game.
Welcome everybody to Friday Night Footy at Colonial with Robert Walls. Walsy, can the champs come back to Kangaroos?
I've got no doubt they can, Bruce. They're a proud team.
I love calling football. I just adore being there. And there's just so much emotion. So much blood spilled every weekend. It's so important to everybody. And you really get wrapped up in it. Once you put those headphones on, you become someone else.
Good looking kick to the goals.
I've gone for the Cats.
I reckon Cats are my best bet this week. I was going to lay money on it.
Dermy, I've actually cut yours and Woolsey's tips out, so I know exactly how you're thinking all weekend.
Did they actually put
diametrically apart?
Did they actually put my tips in this week?
They did. Well, unless they're not yours. And I reckon Woolsey's picked the special of the weekend.
So Friday night footy at Colonial, start of the game, the Cats go to the left of screen. They're playing for a whole lot here tonight. Hey, Dipper, welcome. We wouldn't start without you. You know, the ground looks a bit patchy.
Having played for Hawthorn for 18 years, so, you know, one minute I was bashing them, and then sort of next minute I'm knocking on the door saying, hey, can you let me in and let me find out who's in, who's out, and what's going on? And after a while people say, I'm sorry, Dipper, no media. But hang on, I'm not media, I'm Dipper, you know? I actually don't go near the huddles anymore, I just make it up. I've made it up for nearly 9 years now, because I've heard it all before.
Right smile from the coach. Hopefully Ben Graham might do it. Let's go down back.
Oh, replay on the line. Don't go to break.
Yeah, go back.
Bomber Thompson, break, please.
Yeah, Benny Graham, well, he's the number one mark in the league. He's taken the most.
Would have come here with high hopes. Had a great match individually last week. That's a good kick. He's kicked a second goal.
They're moving this ball on at all costs at the moment. Down towards Lucas and Hurd once again. Stolen, flicked wide. This could be very dangerous. It goes into the right forward pocket.
Television is not an information service. It's not ABC radio. Television is entertainment. So we've got to try and entertain, and I think perhaps some people forget that sometimes and tend to just focus on, well, too much the serious side of sport.
Threw it away. Wrong side for him. Hooks a ball. What a ball! Sensational!
He's taken the wind out of himself. And why wouldn't he? Because he sucked it in from the stratosphere when he was up there.
When that ball was kicked, I thought he's got no chance of marking it. And he's that hot. He just threw himself at it and it stuck. Joe Mussini just looked at the scoreboard and said, I want to see it again.
I tell you what, I look at Chris Tarrant's looking at the scoreboard and saying, I might have lost the car.
That is it. That is it.
Look, unbelievable, Mark. I tell you how good it is. It'll be on CNN.
We head back to Down Under for something special from the Australian Football League, sometimes known as Aussie No Rules. Look at the mark here from Gary Moorcroft.
Hooks a ball.
Nearly knocks me over when a wingman or a rover. It's a forward in the stomach with a bark. And I'll be cheering and a clapping when the opposition captain goes sliding through the goal square on his football jumper.
Do you begin to talk about the magic moments of 45 years? How about the 6th day of June 1999, a Sunday arvo when we were all glued to the box?
Dare I say it is a special day in Australian rules football today. Surely this will be the day. And what irony that the Collingwood
was the quarter time. Plugger goes, he goes, he is! Yeah! Stood at 12.99. Will he write his name in the record book forever?
Come on,
with this kick, it's going to go. Got it! And aren't we privileged to be a little part of it? For however long we play the game, he will be remembered forever.
There is the great plugger. Look at it.
For a bloke who dodged the cameras, in fact, tossed a crutch at them, Tony Lockett was forever being caught in the crossfire, like a big Brahmin in the headlights. Or maybe a plump porker in the pocket.
Oh, there's a pig on the ground. There is a pig at full forward. There is a pig at full forward. Plugger's never forgiven me. No, he's all right now because he's into cattle. The large white land race cross, I think we mentioned at the time, to the SCG and let it run riot for 5 or 6 minutes, but that's part of footy.
Fine tackle.
What a magnificent tackle.
Plugger was a giant of the 80s and 90s, a superstar of the television age.
Lockett, the most important kick of his career. Any score will do. He kicks into the grand final.
Plugger retired at the end of 99 to kick a few goals on Seven's team, along with all the D's. Dunstall, Dermy, Dipper, Dougie.
Mate, it's still rain as you can see here.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed the show.
Carey.
I'll see you again next week on
Just Footy.
The difference between a Carey, a Lockett, a Hurd and the champions before television is that we can only see yesterday's heroes in photographs or rare films. Like this of Hayden Bunton. These are the few images of the playing days of John Coleman, the shooting star of the decade before television.
Here's Coleman at his brilliant best. Yes, he takes a fine mark there with some clever juggling.
These pictures are of Nuts Coventry, the Collingwood goal kicker whose all-time record was broken by Plugger.
Well, here he is in World of Sport to talk with Lou and Jack.
Well, Gordon, firstly, welcome to World of Sports, let's remember. You started in 1921, yet it was 1927 before you won your first goal-kicking competition, or the season's goal-kicking competition. In your first years, did you find it hard to kick goals?
Yes, well, I was half forward.
You were half forward?
Yes.
When did you go to full forward, huh?
Well, after De Klerk retired, he played two or three years after I played.
You had to wait your turn?
Yes.
Likewise. Dacos nearly runs out of room. He's gone!
Goal kickers have always held a special... Oops, there's that word again. A magical attraction for us fans and the cameras.
Oh, Hudson moves in, goes up.
Seven's coverage of the 71 grand final was one of those times when you couldn't take your eyes off the fella in the goal square. Peter Hudson needed four majors to break Bob Pratt's all-time record for a season of 150.
The ball knocked away, looks the players in a bit of trouble, they go through, Hudson's bowled over, and Hudson's hurt. He's hurt.
That was probably the toughest grand final that I ever witnessed. And in the first 10 minutes or so, Cowboy Neil from St Kilda took his ear off. Well, nobody quite knew at the time, but later on that night I saw his ear. I said, God, what's wrong with you? And he doesn't remember that game, Peter Hudson, because Cowboy fixed him right up. And at one stage, over a few beers, Peter Hudson said, I should sue you. And Cowboy said, well, I should sue you too. He said, you know I broke a knuckle in my hand hitting you?
A shaky, uncertain Hutto struggled to three, but this kick, the one that would have rewritten the record book, was disallowed.
Quite right, Mike. You can't do that sort of thing.
Hawthorn are premiers and the final score.
The Hawks won that slugfest by 7 points. The Saints' only flag had come 5 years earlier.
Yes, he's taking your advice, all right, Ted. Can the Saints hang on and win their first ever?
They've got it.
Oh, golly me.
Why not with the ball now? Comes up. It's going to be a good
That's
long kick.
That's a magnificent kick. It's a ripper. They set themselves up. They go. And we find a magnificent mark taken by Waters once again. He goes across the face of goals. He kicks to the flank position on that outer side. They set themselves.
There's
a goal. Tudnham, a break. Tudnham kicks to centre half forward. They set themselves. And a mark to Bob Murray. A mark to Murray. 28 and a half minutes gone.
Hit the boundary line.
28 and a half gone. There's Murray's kick to the wing position on the outer side.
It was just full of drama and emotion. And then Bobby Rose pushing through the... He was coach of Collingwood, pushing through the St Kilda entourage to congratulate Alan Jeans, the coach of St Kilda. And I can still see the tears coming down Bobby's face. And we had tears in the commentary position. That's how moving it was.
During the week before the 66 final, the Poms discovered us.
Brian Sierakowski is one of the star players of St Kilda, the Challengers. He's exactly what the fans like their ball players to be. Big, he's 6'2". Heavy, he's 13 and a half stone. Ruggedly good looking and single.
The BBC ventured down to Moorabbin. And on a chilly September arvo, they filmed Brian Sierakowski in what looked like a scene from Sylvania Waters.
A good Aussie player!
Sierakowski found the bay a lot more friendly than the beaches off his native Perth 30 years later.
The whole head of the shark, which was gnawing through my surf ski and just sort of hit me. It was like a bit of a blow, but he wasn't going to knock me out. He wasn't like a Collingwood football or anything like that.
Bounce the ball at centre half forward there.
Another West Australian, Bert Thornley, was an unwilling extra in football's greatest epic. At half-time in the 1970 grand final, Carlton was 44 points down. And Ron Barassi wanted to make the bold decision to replace Thornley with 19th man Ted Hopkins. Bold because in the days before interchange, this meant that Thornley could not come back on the field if anyone got hurt.
I just had this very strong feeling, a hunch, they're called hunches, that no, Ted's got to go on there. And that's what happened. And he he kicked a couple of quick goals, and the rest is history.
I think there was a lack of leg speed in the team that they, the first 18 they put on the ground, and it wasn't sort of, it was just one of those games where the ball wasn't running well for Carlton. They looked slow. He was a fresh player that had a bit of a reputation for nip, and that was me.
And I can tell you, Carlton are really back in this.
Hopkins fired Carlton's comeback, Barras became a deity, Thornley went home to the West, and that grand final became the most replayed of all, except in Collingwood households.
Congratulations to Bob Rose.
Okay. For the wing position on the member stand side. Oh, just a wing goal!
Television will never let us forget the significance of that moment.
Bring in oxygen. Silvani!
But then, whatever team you barrack for, you can't beat a speggy.
Evans' kick up towards Barker! Magnificent!
Peter Knight's at the back, he broke! Mantra! Oh,
that is the mark of the year!
Hopkins, Palmer! That is unbelievable!
Oh, what a mark of the year! That's beautiful, Mark.
Tearing over the top!
It broke the point post. Oh, talk about a he-man.
Ironically, that busted post was snapped up for $800 by a souvenir hunter named Ron Barassi.
So I've rang up under a false name. I used my wife's maiden name. And so I got this point post because I didn't want to, if I'd mentioned my name, my name was just mud out there because I'd rubbish Lee.
And that's a ripper.
Hendry goes towards Lee Matthews. Matthews racing down the left foot shot.
Lethal Lee was voted the best player of the television era. And he's performed well on both sides of the camera.
That's a great goal.
The coach of the Brisbane Lions, Lee Matthews.
Thanks, Stuart. And it's a cruel irony, you know, that most little kids who weren't even born when I played remember the point post incident and nothing else.
But it was a cameo role on Seven, a flash frame in the background of this picture, that was Lethal's darkest hour.
And they're trying to watch the game at the same time. They just don't know which way to look.
Oh, gee! A Geelong player's gone down behind the play.
So it's
Lee Matthews.
Matthews
goes
so
down.
Matthews in the centre.
A Geelong player went down. Matthews is down. There is... Oh, that's going on everywhere here. And Geelong player is still down.
Lester Smith's got someone down there too.
And so now
I thought earlier,
the goal umpire's out talking to Langford and Jackson. Oh, someone's gone again. The goal umpire has spoken to Langford, spoken to Jackson. Now, I don't know whether Langford's gone or Jackson's gone again. I'm not sure.
Well, all I'm going to say is I don't care.
This is a disgrace.
I don't care who thinks Jackson can play football. He's virtually started all this.
Now, Tom, why didn't you take Jackson off?
Well,
did you think about it?
Yeah.
You've lost control. I think you'd agree with that.
Yes, I could see that he was completely frustrated.
A guy has got a broken jaw in two places, Alan. Did you speak to the player concerned after the game? Have you given your opinion or...?
Peter, if you want to continue with this discussion, and this morning you selected two things. You wanted to go back and dig skeletons out of the cupboard. Now, I can just say to you that certain incidents just happened recently. Now, if you want to go back, it's just as embarrassing for your club. I can recite incidents against the club that you played for, the same as against Geelong. If you want to go back into these incidents. Now, I think you have a certain responsibility to the game, the same as I do. I said I don't condone the thing, and I left it at that. Now, you want to continue with it. Now, just leave it at that at this particular stage.
Thanks, Tom, and thanks, Alan.
And thank you, Peter McKenna. Luckily, Peter could sneak away from the battlefield of world of sport to relax on his Sunday arvo with Don Scott, Sandy Roberts and Slug Jordan, watching a gentle game of the Army Reserve Cup.
I thought, actually, when I was... Oh, he just whacked the umpire. Hey!
Oh, no!
That's unbelievable!
Oh, boy. Well, this is sensational. The umpire has gone down.
Now, there are a number of others coming up to talk to him. Surely we've got to get the Collingwood runner out here and get him off the ground for a spell.
Oh, he whacked
him
out.
He wants to be very careful because...
I'd take him off now. The boy.
Well, he's got him.
I think you've got to take the boy off.
Very smart.
Definitely.
You've got to take
off.
The boy off.
He's leaving the ground.
You've just got to take him off.
Oh, dear, dear, dear.
He whacked the runner now.
Well, he's not a happy boy.
I've never seen that.
No?
Well.
Yeah, I've been around footy scene for a long time.
And we invite you on the Army Reserve Cup and look what's happened.
It has to be complete frustration, I would say. And
You just... Oh, he's going to punch the fella out of the fence.
Someone in the stand. He's into someone in the stand.
Oh, he's giving one too.
Yep.
Yeah, he's done well.
Well, that's very silly.
Do you think you're hard done?
What happens now, John?
John Burke hasn't said this before, but Collingwood actually summoned him to a meeting a few days before that game.
The lead-up was that I'd met with Collingwood, I'm pretty sure, was either on the Tuesday or the Wednesday prior to the Sunday game, which was the infamous game, if you like. And the deal would be that I'd go out there and play well this week, and I'd either, one, be promoted to the Collingwood senior team, two, be offered as to be sold to the Sydney Swans.
He'd spent 4 hours before the tribunal after pleading not guilty to the charge of kicking field umpire Phil Waite during the third quarter.
Burke was disqualified for 10 years, later commuted to 6, and he came back to coach Heidelberg. But that minute of mayhem on television will be with him for life.
I've heard it many, many times. Yeah, you've got to get the boy off. I mean, I'll still hear that, you know, in a joking sort of thing, you know, no matter, you know, even when I was playing and... People would say, oh, you got to get the boy off. And I just think sometimes, look, it's 16 years ago, how long do you want, you know, how long do I have to pay for it? You know, I was suspended from 22 to 28 years of age, so it's 6 years of my prime football career, so I think that was probably enough.
You've got to take the boy off.
Umpire Graham Carberry also copped it from Phil Carman, and Fabulous got 20 weeks.
It's going to be, look at this going on out here.
But undoubtedly the ugliest incident captured on Seven's cameras was the Battle of Windy Hill.
People are laid out everywhere, and Andrews is in, they're all in.
It's hard to imagine a brawl like that these days, and you wonder how old street fighters like Jacko and Ronnie Andrews had coped with trial by video.
Flailing away underneath.
Ron wouldn't have made it through the pre-season competition. I mean, he'd still be serving suspensions from his first pre-season.
Television's definitely cleaned up the game. Obviously the AFL has had a big part to do with that, but the scrutiny of the cameras around the ground. And look, it's obviously more enjoyable to watch.
I remember one with Masiti once when he stuck his leg out against a West Coast player 3 or 4 years ago at the MCG on a Friday night.
Absolutely disgraceful challenge by Masiti on Cousins and White.
And I said something like that was disgraceful. Now, they were poor words. It wasn't a good thing that he did, but it was a poor choice of words by me. And it worried me for a long time. Now, I don't think I've ever said that to anyone because no one's ever asked me.
I always joked with my teammates that while we were doing the warm-up before the game and they were checking the wind and the ground, I was looking where all the cameras were positioned.
Television's been responsible for taking the dirty stuff out of footy. Well, most of it.
And Liberatore's in there, players on the ground. Campbell, this is fantastic.
He's got blood all over him, Knights.
Brown's gone in hard as well.
He has been whacked. That is unbelievable.
I don't go out and play, you know, football. It's not a personality contest for me. It's not a popularity contest. I don't want to be known as the best... you know, the most well-liked person on the field. I'm there to win for the team. Certainly, there's not, you know, I don't ask for applause.
Covered in blood, it was not good for Talib, I tell you.
Well, there was one controversy 19 years ago that was eye-catching. The only grand final participant, as far as I know, who never strapped on a pair of boots or a jockstrap. Nice scarf, though.
Well, when Helen D'Amico came out on the ground, there was this buzz, and you knew something different had happened, something unusual. And I always used to call through binoculars, and I was looking downfield at something. I think Lou was doing the call at the time. And then the streaker bobbed up on screen, and I remember Alf, he cut to a very wide shot, as you would, but that was the widest he could get because all the cameras were on the streaker.
Oh dear, oh dear. Everybody's lost concentration.
She didn't ask for applause either. Believe it or not, the MCG has seen one moment that was even hotter.
Well, you're not going to believe this. The scoreboard here at the MCG is on fire. There are sparks flying. Those flames are really blowing into the night now. This scoreboard could explode. And believe it or not, the players are out on the ground going through their warm-up.
They lead by that bare margin, 20 points, but... In the context, hello, we might really have a...
It was the night the lights went out on AFL football, plunging players, commentators and 40,000 spectators into total darkness and confusion. What resulted was some of the worst crowd behaviour ever seen at a football match, with a near riot.
We viewers have witnessed all sorts of tempests over the years, and that's just inside the coach's box. They've been high-pressure centres, dirty weather, thunder, severe depressions, stormy outbursts, blokes getting unbearably hot under the collar, not to mention the odd cold front.
Another disappointing performance here, and they will be locking the gates to keep the fans in. That is trash. That is absolute. Well, it's a throwaway line that people read. It's a throwaway line that people read. Absolute trash, Jeff. Absolute trash. You want to be let into our rooms, we don't see any more of this crap and we won't be in.
Coaches have their own way of dealing with a heat wave. It's called the Cope Wave.
Look at Kevin Sheedy. What a scene at the MCG as the Bombers advance to the preliminary final.
I just picked my jacket up as I was walking out and, yeah, I was pretty happy. Pretty happy, but you know, I'm not too sure my mother was in the burst, but anyway, that's... You know, your 70-year-old mothers are still giving you a burst at 45 years of age or something. It's a hard job, coaching.
And the marshmallows are flying out here at the moment, Bruce. A few are hitting Kevin, but luckily they're very soft.
Just how did you rate...
Kevin Sheedy and Robert Walls have weathered many an icy blast, but storm warnings were issued as the dark clouds gathered the night Sheeds came in from the cold to talking footy.
Don't talk in riddles. Answer the question, and the question is...
Robert, I never mentioned your name.
Was I a sniper?
All the 70s and 80s, that people out there making the comments. And if said on the radio, if the hat fits, then we all will. And I wrote about myself.
It's just a bit sad that you go so far with your bluff, and when your bluff's called, you back off.
Well, in what way?
Well, you just won't name me.
Well, and why should I?
I don't mind if you name me, to tell you the truth. It doesn't worry me. The one thing I would say...
Probably I didn't come out of a great from a point of view because I wanted to put something on the table and have a fight. Argument, debate, call what you like.
I was really nervous and toey because there'd been a build-up for a week. People knew that we were going to confront each other, if you like, and confront each other we did.
And for you to say that... He went to Brisbane and hid. That's offensive and insulting.
Well, it can be offensive.
Let me tell you, you wouldn't know what it was like to have an owner of a club who wanted to close it down every second week. You wouldn't know what it was like to have 90% of your players who come from outside that state. You don't know really, you haven't got a broad experience of coaching. You've been at the one club for 20 years.
Oh, I've got no problem with that. No, that's all right.
I think the good thing was at the end of it, you know, we shook hands and we can agree to disagree.
Yeah, fairly good way to finish it, don't you?
Once long ago, we think it was grand to watch little leaguers or Highland pipe bands, and we'd sing the club songs of Dons, Hawks or St Kilda and not have to suffer another waltz in Matilda. Now bright stars and big names perform for the fans as they follow the sound, bouncing all round the stands. Fellas, more fallback. Woof.
The jolly swag man
can buy a billabong
under the shade of a colorful tree.
And as Sam as he watched, and he waited till his billy boiled his sand.
You'll come a waltzing Matilda with me.
Down came the chumbuck to drink at the billabong. Up jumped the swagman and grabbed him with glee.
And he sang as he shoved that chumbuck in his tucker bag.
Come waltzing, Matilda, with me.
Waltzing, Matilda. Waltzing, Matilda.
You come waltzing, Matilda, with me.
And he sang as he shoved that chumbuck in his tucker bag.
In just under 70 hours from now, millions of us will be glued to the box for the grand final pre-match entertainment, just like that. And I'll let you in on a little secret. The players might take a sneak look too. Wayne Carey did in 96.
I saw it and just had a, you know, must have been a split second and just thought, oh, that's no good. And then the family reminded me later on that they thought it might have been a bad omen, the fact that, you know, the doll wouldn't blow up.
In 1991, when the Eagles played in their first grand final, their skipper got caught up in the pre-match hoopla.
I just remember running onto the ground, leading the side out, and people still on the ground everywhere, all the formality still going on, and just running around and noticing it all and looking around at the crowd and absorbing it all in and thinking how great it all was. And then, you know, obviously losing the game.
But who wouldn't have been distracted? That was the year of Angry and the Batmobile.
Sing, bound for glory. Always bound for glory. A heartfelt victory and the warrior's destiny.
What a highlight that was. And just as the grand final atmosphere is intoxicating, the post-match can be inebriating.
But with me, I've got two boys. They've both got P plates on their car. Tonight they stand for premierships, Mark Harvey and Paul Salmon. Mark played and Paul put down the great foundation for the club early in the season. And what about the big fella next year?
Well, you know, he was part of it. And he feels a bit out of it at the moment, but, you know, he's part of it. He just feels... Well,
Paul, must have been very, very heart-rending to watch all the boys get the medals, knowing how much you'd put in, the 63 goals in the 13 games. And knowing that you'd have to spend half the season on the sidelines.
It is very hard, but you know, you don't feel a real part of it until you're not played. But
we were, you know, pretty much Pollocks by then. We were well down the track. And unbeknownst to us, we thought we were rather articulate and in pretty good company. And it turns out we were mumbling our words and staggering around the place. And we were only too happy to accommodate anyone who wanted an interview and stuff, because we just remember being just in a euphoric frame of mind.
The Southern Cross a little later.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman.
Stephen Kernahan will really appreciate seeing this footage again.
Your love to just one man. Stand by your man and tell the world you love him.
By the way, the big bloke in the striped shirt in the background, he's now Victoria's Minister for Sport.
Baby, stand by your man. Woo!
Alec, before you go, Alec, is there any chance of marriage between you two?
Oh, we've discussed it, but we haven't come to any decision.
Thank you very much, Alec Epis. And to you, darling, too.
Thank you.
Back in the old days, Lou, on grand final night, was more interested in the players' little friends.
Little friend with you now, that's Diane Jacobs, is it?
That's it.
Your brother is married. Do I hear wedding bells in the distance?
Put it this way, Lou, when you play football, they say once you get married, well, you don't play well afterwards. So I think it's a few years before I get married, don't you?
Diane, what do you think about Alistair as a footballer?
Well, I think he's a very good footballer.
And what do you think about him as a man?
I think he's a very nice man and the best man.
When the Saints begin to end, oh, when the Saints go marching in.
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Whoa, whoa, whoa. You'll be in that number.
As much as we worship the great deeds of footy and glorify the premiership heroes, we footy fans also salute the valiant attempt, the courageous endeavour that doesn't quite make it.
Now presenting the Brownlow medal.
Like Graham Teasdale's Brownlow suit.
To Graham Teasdale.
All of his tie.
At the Southern Cross, I had my first suit. I think I bought it from Nagy, I think, back then. Had a paisley tie on, and it wasn't the best looking tie, I must say. And I was just pretty excited.
He's won it.
The Brownlow was first telecast in 1970, featuring the club captains.
It was at the Southern Cross, and they had all the captains up there turning the numbers by hand, and as they called them out, and you know, a few of us, you know, had a couple of drink early in the night, and we didn't quite get some of the numbers right, and people were yelling, you got it wrong. And
on behalf of the
hey, Greg Northman,
he's won it again. Greg has won it with 27 votes.
The 1975 Brownlow medal to Gary Dempsey.
The winners of the 1981 Brownlow medal.
It's got everything. It's got the glamour. It's got the good-looking bloke and his you know, beautiful partner or wife. The fashion. It's quaint in a way. It's still old-fashioned enough to have all those darn votes read out that seem to take forever, but I'm into.
I think the players are the primary point of interest, but yeah, there's no doubt that the girls enjoy the night, and they come, I suppose, prepared to turn an eye, a lot of them, which is great. It's good for football.
Declare Brian Wilson of the Melbourne Club the winner of the 1982 Brownlow medal. Ross Glendinning, Melbourne's Peter Moore.
Brad Hardy of Footscray.
It is a tie for the 86 Brownlow.
Yeah, I come here for the free feed, actually.
Best. Would you like to thank anybody out there?
What can I say? Thank the umpires. And
my worst nightmare was about the cunt, because it was about 2 hours beforehand, Junior said no more media. Next thing, every camera, every microphone underneath you, and you're thinking, what am I going to say, you know? And I was looking down, I saw Alan Jeans going, oh no, you can't believe that, you know, one, I've won the Brownlow, and two, the media.
Three, Richmond versus Kangaroos.
Well, you try and act natural, I suppose, which comes across completely unnatural.
Richmond.
Because the glass in front of you is the important prop. You've got to have your glass always full, because you've got to have something when the camera's on you to throw to.
It's actually a bit like New Year's Eve. Like, you build it up to be something fantastic, and then you get there and it sometimes turns out to be not as great as what you expected it to be.
I declare Shane Crawford the winner of the 1999 Brownlow medal.
So for one person that night, life will never be the same again. Now, how many nights can we say that's going to happen in our life?
Diane, how do you feel about Shane and his achievements tonight?
I think it's absolutely wonderful, and I'm so proud.
I'm going to start crying. Football is hard to cry.
You can cry as much as you like.
Jim Steins from the Melbourne Football Club, the winner, the 1991 Brownlow medal.
But if you want to turn a Brownlow night into a real party, give the medal to an Irishman.
Presentation area, Jim with his father, Brian.
Come in, Brian.
Jim's dad, Brian.
Jim?
Yep, how are you?
It's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah,
I'm delighted with you.
I can't listen to you. I'll only start crying if you start talking to
you. Brian, Jim, Tess, the Steins family, they'll be celebrating right around the world. We'll take a break.
Hang on, I've got to take a few people. Hang on.
Okay, go. Why not? It's live.
I really appreciate both my dad and John for being fantastic. Also, the rest of the players, it's hard coming out to a club and coming out to Australia, but the guys at Melbourne have been fantastic.
Well, the girls are so pretty, I curse that my eyes aren't sweet Molly.
Digest and dissect the jargon and rhetoric. Commentators inject. Come on, old-timers.
What do you say about the fat side, corridor and all of that guff? Are they making it up? Is it all just a bluff? When there's nothing to say, they the ones saying it. Now let's go to a commercial, because they're the ones paying for it.
Jacko, when you think about the great entertainers, he isn't one of them. As Calvin Moore said, not as long as his bum points to the ground. And talking about bums, Warwick Capper's shorts couldn't contain his bursting talents. After that, Warwick packed his bags for Brisbane, while Jacko went straight to Hollywood. Despite that, some Americans have come to embrace our game.
Yeah, nice pass.
What is that, rugby?
No, Australian League football, live from Melbourne.
Yeah. I don't want to hear any more of this noise.
Well, even if he doesn't give a continental, the Germans do.
Handpass auf Andrew Thompson. Doppelpass. Schuss. Tor! Unglaublich. Was für ein Treffer. Aussie Jones.
So footy crosses all languages. In fact, sometimes I think our commentators have invented a new language altogether.
I don't understand it. And some of the descriptions is as if it's a foreign game. I don't understand it, but I'm yesterday's man.
That to run through the lines on a link handball.
Breaks the line. He's a 50% charge from here. Oh. He is a beauty.
Spots a man towards the outer side. Hum tracking it.
You stand in the outer or sit in the outer. What they want to know is who's got the ball and what the bloody score is and who won the third race at Flemington.
There's big space out on this fat side of the ground.
Could you tell me just exactly where is the fat part of the ground? Is that where they sell pies or something? I mean, fair dinkum.
They've picked a hole in the zone.
He's got outriders, he's got...
He unloads a bomb. It is a big, big bomb. What a reply.
Well, Sandy wants to anticipate and this will happen, you know. And it's very good. Bruce gets very excited about it, you know. Dennis Cometti is extremely precise about what he does.
Dennis Cometti probably has got most of them, but the centimetre perfect one is one that people enjoy, I think. And the other one was when Peter Wilson kicked a pretty important goal in the 92 grand final over his head, and it was like a cork in the ocean as he bobbed up.
Wilson, like a cork in the ocean over his head.
I'm talking about Smoke and Joe, and he's kicking to the hot spot.
I think most of the new terminology is coming from ex-players and coaches, not from broadcasters. So, fat side of the ground, corridors, that's pretty ancient now, run with rather than tags. I remember Blighty coming and talking to us as a group when he was coaching Geelong and saying, they're not taggers, they're run with players.
In the corridor, under pressure.
We've got the corridor, we've got the fat side, the thin side, we've got the stoppages. If you're in the inner circle of football, you know what that means. You know, that's coach speak and the players grow up with it, the current day players.
Grant led to the fat side, the open side, but in the end...
Mark Johnson, good switch.
Tell me the last time you saw a rover go to the forward pocket to rest and a follower go to the back pocket to rest and a ruckman go to the other forward pocket to rest, and we had 18 players and two blokes that came on if two blokes got injured. So why shouldn't the broadcast and the callers keep up with the times?
Brown, their go-to man, as Dermot mentioned last year. Great-looking kick to Ellis Goddard.
Had some serious ugly on it, Wolsey.
Yes, but when they're ugly like that, Dermot, into your forward 50, it is a 50-50 chance for the forwards.
If the ball...
Pull the ladder now. Sensational, mate. Believe it's sensational.
You just love playing this game, don't you?
I love it.
Thanks. Go ahead, buddy. Well, a few good words there by the liver.
Sometimes the language of footy is just plain old bad language.
We've been talking about what it was doing.
But the grand master of football vernacular has to be that linguistic legend, Jack Dyer, whose column in the Truth newspaper had the appropriate name, Diarrhea.
About 2 weeks.
As Tigers coach, he once told his players to pair off into threes. As a commentator, he described Justin Madden's arms as two giant testicles. And as an interviewer, he was a hell of a player.
Because Jack used to have this interviewing technique of saying the new kid had come on, and Jack would say, "Oh, where are you from? Corowa. Oh, yeah. How heavy are you? Oh, 12 and a half stone. How tall are you? Oh, 6'2". Well, he said, "You are a tall boy." You know, that Jack, that was Jack's opening gambit with most of them, you know. Yeah, he used to, or he'd say, "And what's your height and weight, and how tall are you?" That was another one.
A young fellow had come in for his first game. Sit down and Jack would say, "How big are you? How tall are you? How old are you? What school did you go to, son?" And the same questions. And you're tough. You reckon you'll be able to keep up with these boys today? The same questions, but they're a beautiful question.
No, it's not right at all. We didn't shoot Dutch.
Who are you wrapped in the Hawthorne side? Apparently you're
wrapped. Darkie Nelda and Brendan Edwards.
Do you think Brendan's back in town again?
Too right.
What about John Peck? Is he your favourite?
Pecky? Oh, yes, he's one of them.
And what do you think about the umpire? I think you'd have a word to say about him.
Shocking.
He's shocking.
Jack McMurray, it's nice to have you here.
Thank you for the time, John.
I have your record in front of me here, and what you've missed out on doing, well, it's not worth mentioning here, as a matter of fact. I can't go through it because it would take me all day.
Yes, I get you.
And you did a lot of miles too, didn't you, Jack?
Yeah, listen, you're on my deaf side and I can't even have the other one.
I knew I'd make a mistake. I knew I would.
Listen, I'm playing McIntosh.
Yeah, he could fight too.
Who said so?
I did. Colin Watson, yes. I played against him, so be careful.
I beg your pardon?
Now, don't tell anything they shouldn't tell about Colin Watson, because I played against him.
Next one, this was a great footballer too, was
I? Ivor Ward Smith is one of the best footballers along.
How do you know I was going to say that?
All right, go to it. Listen, you'll go out for a fortnight, I've seen any conduct.
You always said 7 weeks when I was playing.
Did you play? Who did you play with?
And I was waiting for you to report me, but you never.
Report you? I should have deported you.
Is a pair of jacks a full hand or a handful? Unk, you're a card. There's more magic moments coming your way. A flaming good score. Nice flick pass, EJ. Keep swinging with Kevin and that bloke with the name. Ah, footy and seven. It won't be the same. Solvent.
You know, finding idols for kids to enrich their dreams with.
People give television a bit of a hard time. I mean, I think it serves the sport a great purpose because it, people sometimes can't afford to go to the footy. They can't afford the time. They're not well. They're too far away. So these people can see the game.
And it's even trying to take the viewer to places he never went before, like a dressing room. Now, people have really got a fascination about the dressing room, and it's not the nudity, I'm sure, just to see what happens that we can't see. Like, what happens pre-game? And now, I mean, so many people love just going in there and just being part of the camera in the theme song for the winning team, and it sort of takes you places you'd never been before.
Footy's taken us lots of places, and tonight we've travelled through the back alleys of our memories and across lots of familiar turf to relive the journey. I just hope we haven't left too much out.
Hey, Kev, it's Big Rexy here. Now, mate, goals win and lose matches, and we've gone almost 2 hours without having a look at some of the goals.
There's a booming torpedo kick from Ferrick to full forward. Goal! Doing a great job. Well smothered, though, by Mazzasto. Picks it up and has a snapshot of goal. And it's got it through. Over to Buse. Here he comes, a little rover. Oh, bad luck. He pressed his way through. Now he's got it again. Oh, boy. He hooks it back. Don't tell me he's going to score a goal.
Away by Keyes. Here's the magician near the boundary line. 30 metres out, Peter Dacos. Three kicks, three goals! Here's Brownless and Abbott. Here's Gazza, the great man. Left foot snap. Oh,
shot by Smith, taken by Mitchell. Some speed here. Look at him go. Michael Mitchell, a third bounce. He's running towards the 50. Oh. He wants to kick a goal. No question about that. Watch this. I want a goal, Michael Mitchell says to himself.
Ground level, pounced on by Farmer. Kicked a couple already. He's dangerous. The Wizard runs the centre wing, pops it short to Gary Lyon, and keeps running. The Wizard, he's got it. He's going to take him on. Runs the 50. Great play. This could go through, but bounces. It's a goal.
Gets past Brown. They're lifting the pies. They can sense it. First 15 minutes ordinary, but since then they've been good. McGuan's had five bounces. Still, he gets another one. Round he goes. In he goes to an open goal.
And Rex, here's one for you.
Yibbida. Thank you very much.
Rex's Sunday morning panel will be back next year. Oh, well. So we'll talk and footy.
And talking footy is going to have a brand new member, Tim Watson. Tim, I'm looking forward to having you on the couch.
I'm looking forward to being part of talking footy next year.
So, it's going to be a great show, and I dare say, Kevin, it's going to be very, very special.
Yeah, well, this whole show has been... I'll bugger it, special. So before footy leaves its home ground, let's have one last word from the blokes who've ruled our weekends for all these years. Where's the remote?
I tell you one thing, Bob. Here at TV Ringside, I can say this honestly, you're amongst friends.
Yeah, but I reckon I would have stopped it earlier.
It has made my life, you know, most enjoyable, and apart from my own family, I think Channel 7 has been a great family for me for a long, long time.
Well, I was looked upon myself as a fan who was lucky enough to be in the commentary box, sitting with some of the legends of the game, calling a match.
It's not scripted. It comes from the top of your head and from somewhere in your heart and intellect, you know, all combined. And not everything's going to be perfect. So there are a lot of things I'd like to have taken back, and there's a few things that I'm quite happy can stay out.
You know, life goes on. There's more to life than football, but there will be, I think, a huge emotional letdown, and people probably tend to forget that it's, you know, a lot of times, rightly or wrongly, they look at the commentators, but it's the cameramen who, for 25 or 30 years, have said goodbye to their wives and families for the weekend. It's the lighting guys, it's the audio guys, it's the technicians.
Yeah, it's still time to move on, yeah.
Yeah, I'll say my goodbyes. We'd have to come and think of a quote or something, you know.
I was just thinking what I wanted to do to mark the occasion. I've always wanted to sing on TV.
So, folks, thanks for watching. You fanned the flame of the fire in the heart of the game.
Oh, I'd know she'd work and slave for me every day. She'd be so unhappy if I went away. I've got a girl crazy for me. She's funny that way. You want any more?